Good morning, Valley Mills Christian Church. I'm so glad to see y'all here this morning. Hope y'all braved that bitter cold yesterday. But today, good thing it's going to get a little bit warmer. Would you stand? Let's pray together as we get started into our worship service. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day that we can come here and worship you. God, I pray that in every action that we take and where we direct our minds and hearts today, God, it would go to glorify you. God, let this be our worship to you this morning. And God, as we take it out into the world throughout the rest of the week, God, we thank you most of all for your son, Jesus, who is the hope that we have of everlasting life with you if we put our faith in him. And God, I pray that you be with those who are not able to make it in here today for whatever reason. God, please be with them and encourage them. I pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, let's lift up our voices together as we sing these songs.
Done great things. A hero of heaven.
God's been faithful to us every day, every morning, every night. As sure as the sun rises in the east and sets in the west, so will his faithfulness be steadfast for us. And we can rest in that truth this morning. Let's continue singing these songs of worship together. I count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Yes, I
great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. And the work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin.
Dear God, thank you for this truth that we have just uttered with our voices and our mouths. God, I pray that these words take root in our lives and in our hearts. God, that Jesus Christ is our living hope. God, that we have hope through him, through his life, death, and resurrection. God, I pray that if anyone in here today, this morning, is feeling any kind of sense of doubt or is maybe discouraged, or maybe has this outlook on life that it just seems hopeless, God, I pray that they can embrace this truth, that Jesus Christ is our living hope. God, I pray that your Holy Spirit works in the hearts and minds of those here today that have not decided to follow you. God, I pray that they feel your love today. God, that they know your love intellectually today. God, and by the receiving of the word today, God, that they would know the truth from hearing of your word. God, I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
Morning, everyone. So good to see you today. Welcome to the 10:45 service at Valley Mills Christian Church. We're glad you chose to worship here with us, part of the family of God here at Valley Mills. And those online, we welcome you as well and hope God's blessing is upon you as you hear the word today. We are continuing our study about the changed life. We're going to be studying from Matthew chapter 7 in the New Testament and also from the book of James. So let's go ahead and begin with a question. When you think about a changed life, what does that mean to you? What do you think about when you think about a changed life? Well, it's easy to think in terms of things we have stopped doing, things we're not doing anymore. But today, God would want us to think about things we are doing, things we are beginning to do differently, that not just things we quit, but things we embrace and pick up that are positive, that are meaningful, that are making changes in the lives of others around us and in our lives as well, and honoring God. What's it like to have godly thoughts? What's it like to saturate our minds with the things of God so that we can walk in His ways? See, Christianity is not just the things we've stopped doing, but things we begin doing differently because Christ in us. We're new creatures in Christ. And it's exciting. The new life in Christ is exciting. It's difficult. How many of you would agree that being a Christian in this day and age is difficult sometimes? But it's worth it. And God would want you to know that there is no greater friend than God and God alone. God loves you with an unconditional love. He loves you with a mercy that doesn't punish you for what you and I should deserve. And it makes me want to sing hallelujah because God is great and greatly to be praised. And when God brings something that profound to you, you cannot keep it to yourself. And that's what we're talking about when I think Jesus is going to teach us here today about the changed life. It's not merely things we stop doing, but things that you begin to do because you're walking in a new life. And so we have the golden rule. What might be known as the golden rule, let's say Matthew 7:12, when Jesus continues his teaching on the Sermon on the Mount, where he was up on a mountain slope, and yet there was this amphitheater of people assembled there, able to hear him, even though he didn't have a microphone. The conditions in that area were so wonderful that literally thousands could gather and hear what Jesus was teaching about. What he says is something you've probably read many, many times, and something yet that it goes much deeper than the surface. He says, whatever you wish that others would do to you, do also to them, for this is the law and the prophets. He's saying that, Jesus is saying that this kind of like summarizes the whole Bible. Of course, a couple chapters later, he goes in Matthew 22 and says, the greatest commandment is to love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Isn't that a marvelous thing to think the God of the universe would love me and give me the ability to love him back because my sins are forgiven in Jesus Christ? I can stand before a holy God and thank him and praise him and worship him. The greatest commandment is like if you spent your time doing everything to grow in the love of God, then the second commandment would be easy. Love God with all your heart and love your neighbor as yourself. This teaching is similar to that, and it kind of preceded that a little bit in the book of Matthew, where Jesus says something a little different, but yet similar. That is, whatever you wish that others would do for you, do also for them. You know, it's kind of simple. What is it that you want? What is it that you want in life that's good and blessed and godly? Jesus would say, help others to obtain the same thing. Rules alone are merely outward and are, you know, kind of like involve compliance. Like the gospel, the good news is not about rule keeping. And so even though this is called, you know, the golden rule, it's not that your faith and my faith is measured in rule keeping. But if for some of you who need a rule to follow, if you're a rule follower and you say like, yes, I should do this, I should do that, don't do this, Jesus is saying the greatest rule of all would be love your neighbor as yourself and do to them what you would want done to you. And Jesus starts with the heart. If you keep your faith to yourself, I believe you could be considered selfish. If you keep hope to yourself, I think you could be selfish. If you keep love only to yourself, you want to be loved, but you don't want to take the effort to love others, I think that is selfishness. If you need faith, hope, and love, then come to Jesus. Come to God, who is giver of all those things and more, and he'll give generously. James, in his book, weighed in on the golden rule. And in many ways, his letter is a practical commentary of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. This would be natural as James grew up with Jesus, his older half-brother, and was influenced by him throughout his childhood. And so in James 8, he writes this: if you really fulfill the royal law according to Scripture, you shall love your neighbor as yourself, you're doing well. James 2:16, for judgment is without mercy to the one who has shown no mercy. Mercy triumphs over judgment. In James 2:17, so also faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by works, is dead. And read with me, if you would like, James 3:13 through 18. He continues on, who is wise and understanding among you? Who is wise and understanding among you? By his good conduct, let him show his works in the meekness of wisdom. But if you have bitter jealousy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast and be false to the truth. This is not the wisdom that comes down from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, demonic. For where jealousy and selfish ambition exist, there will be disorder in every vile practice. But the wisdom from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, impartial, sincere. And a harvest of righteousness is sown in peace by all those who make peace. And so we see this idea that the gospel, the good news of Jesus, is that he's done something for me that I don't deserve. And the Christian life is to be a life of two things. Thank you, God, for your incredible mercy upon me. Now help me to go and do the same. That's the golden rule in a nutshell. Thank you, God, for your mercy. Help me to go around and give mercy. Thank you for showing me what love really is. Help me to give love. Thank you for forgiving me. Help me to forgive even the hardest person, even if it's my spouse, my children, my father, my mother. God, help me to do to others what I want done to me and what you have given me. Micah in the Old Testament, chapter 6:8. There's this amazing passage, and Micah was basically begging the Hebrew people to follow these sound principles so that Israel would be walking in the ways of God. He has told you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you? But to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God. Mark Batterson, in his book Not Safe, said, I'm afraid we've reduced righteousness to the absence of wrongness, but goodness, the golden rule, states that you can do nothing and still, you can do nothing wrong and still do nothing right. Think about that. You can do nothing wrong, but you still might not be doing anything right. The gospel is proactive. The gospel is active. It is not busyness, but it's activity of giving because I have received. Faith is transformational from the inside out. What God does is He comes to us and He gives us a new heart, a new mind, and we're able to live out differently. Grace and truth extend beyond ourselves to others. And so if you've been touched by Jesus, you must give that away. The greatest gift of all. You can't keep to yourself. And that's why many of you, you're thinking about how to do that. I hear you talking about, you know, maybe God let me live a little longer so that I can figure out what am I supposed to be doing, God? And I hope after today's message, you will realize that you don't have to have some big divine revelation from God. You might, but you can just begin in simple ways to live a life of meaning and purpose. Jesus said you'll know them by their fruits. I hadn't done this really in a while. I didn't do it in the first service. I think I'm going to do it now. It's kind of like embarrass someone. Use someone as a sermon illustration. Tessa, would you come up for just a minute, please? Oh, yeah, a hand for Tessa. She's not shy. She's an awesome person. Okay, pretend like you're a tree. Do trees smile? This tree smiles, so you can smile. Now, go ahead. Just show me some limbs. All right. Now, what kind of fruit you got? What kind of spiritual fruit you got hanging off your spiritual limbs? Anything? What? Lemons. Lemons? Lemons. Okay, what other kind of... Let's talk about spiritual fruit. What kind of things has God allowed you to learn and to live out as you have been a Christian and as you've been following Him, even though it's hard? What kind of things has God allowed Tessa to develop in her character and in her person to help other people? What kind of good things has God allowed you to develop in your life? You got any thoughts? Be nice to your brother. Be nice to your brother. Yeah, that's one. Got any other thoughts? Love and obey your parents. Is that easy? No. That's it. She's got the spiritual fruit of honesty. All right. Let's give Tessa a hand. Thank you, Tessa. And Tessa vows to never come back to this church again. But really, you think about it. What kind of spiritual fruit you got hanging off your tree? Do people see anything different in you because God is in you? Listen to Galatians 5, 22 through 26. But the fruit of the Spirit is love. He starts out with something that's probably the hardest thing. No matter how many times you've said it, you thought it, love is one of the most amazing things, but it's one of the most hard things. Because why? We don't forget. When somebody does something wrong, we just kind of chalk it up. And every time something chalks up negative, love gets squeezed out more and more and more. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness. You might say, Bob, you're not being very gentle right now. It's because I want to emphasize that. Let God go to war for you. Let your yes be yes and your no be no. If somebody opposes you, if somebody makes fun of you, you don't have to lash back. Show them a better way, which is the love of God, the peace and security of the Holy Spirit. Be a person of peace, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, self-control. And so God gives us some of these qualities. They're called the fruit of the Spirit. Don't ever let anybody call you a fruitcake, okay? You say, I'm no fruitcake. I got the fruit of the Spirit in me. Here's an example of some people that I don't even know if they're Christians or not, but they're exhibiting Christ-like qualities. And I want to take a few moments and show you some examples. I know many of you, your picture could be up here. But let's start out with Ukraine, because it's such a horror to see the injustice seemingly being done for whatever reason, to grab land, to gain mineral rights and another, I don't know what it is, but people are being murdered, innocent people for no reason at all. And you know what these are? These are like baby carriages, strollers. Think about it. The men, teenage boys up to 60, cannot leave Ukraine because they got to stay back and fight. Mothers, women, single, married, children in the bitter cold are trying to escape to another country to find freedom, to stay alive. Some of them by train, some of them by other means. They come to places like Poland, maybe other places like Hungary, Moldova, Romania, Slovakia, and they show up with next to nothing. And in some of these train stations, they're greeted with bags of food, shopping carts of food, diapers, you know, baby strollers. Why? Because the people there are trying to give something to them. When they come, they'll be met with a blessing. They're giving away something that they have. Some of them are even taking them and keeping them in their own homes. They don't know these people, but they're exhibiting the qualities of God. They're treating their neighbor like they would want their neighbor to treat them. Matthew 7:12 again. So whatever you wish others would do to you, do also for them. For this is the law and the prophets. I know of somebody recently in our church that gave a car to some family that needed a car. And it was no ordinary car. It was a nice car, kind of like this. BMW, station wagon. It shows you that station wagons can still be cool. Now, I made the mistake in the first service of thinking I knew what BMW stood for, because I guess I've watched too many James Bond movies, so I said British Motor Works, and I was corrected by our children's minister's husband. I guess maybe the right way is to say Bershe Motor Works or Bavarian Motor Works. I don't know. Take it up with Keith. Apparently, I don't know what I'm talking about, but this is a BMW. This was a car that was recently given by someone right here today in this service to someone else in our church who was really struggling and needed a car. Here's my car. Here's the keys. You don't need to bring it back. Do to others what you would want them to do to you. I know of someone in our church right now, a young man who needs a reliable car. If you feel compelled to give an extra car that you really don't need, doesn't have to be a real expensive car, come see me. Or maybe you just need a little bit of money for it, but you have a reliable car. Come see me, because I can connect you with somebody who would really benefit from it. Last year, our ladies' ministry gave over $1,000 to the ladies and girls of Langus Christian Church. And it is more blessed to give than receive, because you see what giving does to people. Several people in our church are involved in our seniors' ministry at Worthington Place. Matter of fact, we're going there today at 1:30. Here's Lisa on the keyboards. Then there's a couple other crazy characters. Bill, basically speaking to the people. His lovely wife, Martine, getting ready to throw something at me. Actually, I think she's got a shaker. But we love to go there with the residents once a month and just give to them what someone has given to us. Miss D, someone I know, part of our church, works at Walmart and greets me once in a while when I go to Walmart. And by the way, I don't go to Walmart in my pajamas. I wear clothes. I've been tempted to go in my pajamas. But when I go to Walmart, about half the time I see Miss D on the way out, and she knows when they run the sales. And I'm talking like the really amazing sales that maybe even others don't know about. And they're like, get this stuff out of here. And she invited me over a couple weeks ago to her and her husband's house and said, I got some bags of brand new clothing for children and, you know, youth. I went over there, and to my surprise, there was so many clothes. Like, I couldn't even lift the bags. I couldn't even lift the boxes to put into my four-door truck. We had to, like, drag them down. And now she tells me there's more clothes coming. And I was here this week to be a part of helping Tanya Henthorne give them away to some needy children and teenagers in our area. Miss D, thank you for your generosity to give to others as you would hope they would give to you in your time of need. Many of you right here are involved in our meals ministry. I didn't have any pictures of you in action, but I did have a picture of the food. And at the 9 o'clock service, I said many of you are involved in our men's ministry. And I inadvertently should have said, I said that instead of meals. But, you know, men need food too, right? It's right. But anyhow, thank you. Those of you who are involved in a meals ministry, those of you who have cooked something for someone who is sick, someone who is homebound, someone who just got out of the hospital, thank you for those of you who participate in this very needy ministry. A recent mission trip to Kentucky, some of our men went down and ministered not only physically but spiritually to some of the needs of the residents down there in Kentucky after the tornado disaster. Bible Mission, a mission organization out of Ukraine, continues to minister, the UK, continues to minister to Ukrainian people, giving out hope through Bibles and other books of encouragement, even in the midst of danger. I had this given to me earlier today. It's an envelope with a fair amount of money in it that was given on Kitty Ratcliffe's behalf upon her recent passing by her family members who wanted to have some money donated to our food pantry to help bless other people. Kitty loved to cook, and she did such a great job by blessing other people. At her funeral, I was reminded she had made over 300 quilts and given them to just people all the time, whenever there was a new birth of a child, and my children have been the recipient of that upon the birth of their children. You know, we could go on and on and on just to give examples. Many of you call, you write letters to people you haven't seen in a while. You keep connected with and pray with people who are in the hospital or maybe just got out. Keep up the good work. People in our drama ministry, men serving in our leadership teams, elders, deacons, people, many of you involved in our children's ministry, our student ministry, coffee shop ministry, community garden, feeding the hungry, foster care and adoption. The list could go on. Thank you. God knows who you are. Thank you for your care. And the question I want to ask us today is this. To what degree are others benefiting from your faith? To what degree are others benefiting from your faith? That's what we're talking about today. That's what the golden rule is all about. What God has given you, you're passing along. Do to others as you would have them do to you, as God has done to you. The phrase one another occurs over 100 times in the New Testament. Speaking of encouraging one another, you know, supporting one another. Right now we've got a new Valley Mills Christian Church encouragement team that's been kind of put together by Robin Paul and Tanya Gontraman. Even though they're not running it, they're organizing it. And guess what? You don't need a resume to apply. You just raise your hand. If you want to encourage people, if you want to help people, we're going to have a little brief training session. We're going to tell you people you can contact, and you can get busy having a lot of fun ministering to people who need a touch of encouragement. God brings life to you so you can help others discover life. God brings joy to you so you can help others have joy. God forgives you so that you can forgive those around you and those in your circles. God brings truth to you so that you have something to stand on in hard times. God brings peace and comfort so you can care for others. No matter how much you've been hurt or abused, God gives you something you didn't have, and He wants you to share that. So whatever you wish that others would do to you, do that to them, for this is the law and the prophets. You know, the Sermon on the Mount, we see Jesus flipping upside down this conventional wisdom. Instead of an eye and an eye and a tooth for a tooth, well, you know, she did this to me, so I'm going to do that to her. I'm going to one-up it, make her feel the pain. I'm going to make my husband feel the pain, make my wife feel the pain. I'm just going to dig in there and grind it a little deeper. All that is changed when Jesus comes. He brings new life when we didn't deserve it. He brings forgiveness of sins so that I can stand before God. I have received the greatest gift of all. Thank you, Father. Let me spend my days praising you by giving it away. It didn't cost a dime to give away something that God has given you. And maybe you don't have something to give away. Maybe you don't understand it. You see it, but you don't quite understand it yet. What it involves is just surrendering to God and saying, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Because sin separates us from God. And then Jesus comes and He removes the sin barrier so that I'm free from the greatest bondage of all, which is sin and death and punishment. And I'm able to stand before God. I'm able to love my neighbor, maybe for the first time. I'm able to forgive. I'm able to develop qualities that God has called me to. We feel good about ourselves as we go about our daily tasks. We are minding our business and doing nothing to others that would be considered disrespectful. But Jesus taught His followers that just not doing wrong is not good enough to satisfy the demands of His new teaching. We must be relentless in doing good. Relentless in doing good. It's not just what I don't do. It's what I am now doing. Faith is not just keeping from sin, but spiritual acts of service to honor God and to help anyone and everyone. And if you think you're going to give and give and give and you're going to run out of something to give, that simply is not true. God will never let you run empty unless you're not in touch with Him. Because when you're in touch with the Creator of the world, of the universe, of the galaxy, you have unlimited resources to continue to give to others. It could be financially. It could be an ear to listen. It could be in so many ways. God has given you right now, each one of us, so many things, talents, ability, passion. Let's spend our days giving like we would want people to give to us. This week while I was finishing this message, I was listening to a YouTube song. I like listening to music. Do you got any people in here who like listening to music? Like, do y'all just listen to one style of music? Or do you got like different styles you listen to? Like, if you like different styles of music, just raise your hand. If you're just stuck on one genre, raise your hand. Tom's over here like, yeah, I just like elevator music. No. He was a rocker one time. I like all kinds of music. And my wife is a dear help to me because sometimes the old dial gets over there on the old Karen Carpenter channel, the Carpenters, and I can't help it. You know, rainy days and Mondays get me down. And she's like, why are you crying? I'm listening to the Carpenters. Well, stop listening to the Carpenters. But in all seriousness, I was listening to a video this week by a group named Alabama. And it brought me to tears. Matter of fact, I didn't know if I was going to want to show it today because I might be sitting on the front row blubbering, out of control, crying, because I don't know what it is. This subject is dear and near to my heart because so many people have given to me and my family to help us be who we are and where we are because they knew the love of God and they helped us. And I want to spend my days doing that. And this song talks about angels among us. We're going to listen to this video, and then we're going to have an invitation, a time for you to respond. And I just want to ask you, would you be an angel to someone? Would you take it upon yourself to be an angel to someone?
I was walking home from school on a cold winter day. Took a shortcut through the woods, and I lost my way. It was getting late, and I was scared and alone. But then a kind old man took my hand and led me home. Now, Mama couldn't see him. Oh, but he was standing there, and I knew in my heart he was the answer to my prayers. Oh, I believe there are angels among us, sent down to us from somewhere up above. They come to you and me. In our darkest hours, to show us how to live, to teach us how to give, to guide us with the light of love. When life held troubled times and had me down on my knees, there's always been someone come along and comfort me. A kind word from a stranger to lend a helping hand. A phone call from a friend just to say I understand. But ain't it kind of funny at the dark end of the road that someone lights the way with just a single ray of hope? Oh, from somewhere up above, they come to you and me. In our darkest hours, to show us how to live, to teach us how to give, to guide us with the light of love. They wear so many faces, show to grace us with their mercy in our time of need. Oh, I believe there are angels among us, sent down to us from somewhere up above. They come to you and me in our darkest hours. Show us how to live, to teach us how to give, to guide us with the light of love, to guide us with the light of love.
We've come to the time of our service where we dedicate to just intentionally for you, if you have decided to place your faith and trust and hope in and on the person of Jesus Christ, to come forward as we sing this song. Would you stand as we sing our song of invitation this morning? Now, we sang this song early at first service, and it's a song we recently introduced not too long ago. It's called His Mercy Is More. And I think this really just encapsulates what it means and what happens as a result when we give our lives to Jesus Christ. It doesn't matter how much we sin in our lives, if we place our trust and faith and hope in Jesus Christ, as much as we sin, Christ's sacrifice on the cross is more. Christ's love for us is more. God's love for us is more than our sin. And we have reason to hope in that and to rejoice in that fact. Let's join together as we sing this song.
And praise the Lord, His mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are mended. His mercy is more. Remember no wrongs we have done.
To come on up. I have with me this morning Stephanie and her boyfriend Matt. Stephanie has come forward to accept Jesus Christ as her Savior and be baptized this morning. So Stephanie, if you will, repeat after me. I believe.
I believe.
That Jesus is the Christ.
That Jesus is the Christ.
The Son of the living God.
The Son of the living God.
He has died for my sins.
He has died for my sins.
And from this moment forward.
And from this moment forward.
I will serve him all of my days.
I will serve him all of my days.
All right, let's pray together. Father, we just thank you, Lord, for Stephanie coming up this morning just to accept you and to walk in your ways. God, we know that we are not perfect and that we need you so badly. We just pray that you would continue to show her the loving kindness that you have shown her all of her life, and God, that Matt would be a source of strength to her, and that we as her church would also be a source of strength and love. God, we love you and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's stand up and let's sing through that song once again as they get ready for baptism. And as we sing this, let's reflect on what these words mean. And I urge you guys, as we're singing this song and as they're getting ready, if you would like to make that same decision, I mean, this would be a perfect time, a great time. We don't want to push that off any further. We're not promised tomorrow. Let's join and sing this song together.
Praise the Lord, His mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. What love could remember no wrongs we have done? Omniscient, all-knowing, He counts not their sons. praise the Lord, His mercy is more, stronger than darkness through every morn, our sins they are many, His mercy is more. Would wait as we constantly roam, but Father so tender is calling us home. He welcomes the weakest, the vilest, the poor. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord, His mercy is more, stronger than darkness through every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. What riches of kindness He lavished on us. His blood was a payment, His life was a cost. We stood neath the debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more.
You may be seated.
Stephanie, with the confession of your faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Oh, man. Praise the Lord, huh? You know, now we'll have our time for offering and stuff. And if you're visiting with us, we have three baskets in back or three stands where you can give. That's for our mission of the month, which is Shepherd's Gate down in Martinsville. It's a retreat that pastors and leadership can go to get a little rest and peace away from the busyness of what ministry is. And then there's also, if you're just giving offering, there's a couple boxes, one outside and then one outside the north door here. We'll pray for offering now and then we'll do communion. Father, we just thank you for this opportunity you've given us to give back to you. And Father, we're never going to repay the great gift you gave us of your Son. And Father, we thank you for the visual gift that we just received with Stephanie confessing her faith for you and being a willing servant now the rest of her life. And Father, we just thank you for that gift of baptism and the visual that it gives us. So again, Father, we just ask now that we would be good stewards with the tithes and offerings that we've entrusted to us. And Father, we thank you again for the country that you'll bless us with. Father, we thank you for the peace that we're allowed to come and worship with. So again, Father, we thank you for this time where we can honestly give back to you truly all that you have given us. It's in your Son's name we pray. Amen. You know, I known some time ago that Bob's sermon was going to be on the golden rule. And, you know, I was thinking about that. You know, when you read it, it says, you know, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. And you look at others and you think, well, who is others? Okay, well, others is not just who we're encompassed with here of a morning from 8:30 to 12 on Sundays. Others is the guy that just cuts you off on the interstate. Others is the guy who just ran a loaded full of groceries in front of you while you had two items. Others is the guy who just picked up the last item you were looking for. How do we treat them? I got to tell you, me and my honest flesh, I don't do well with that. And I'm just being, you know, you think just because we're here as a leadership or an elder that maybe we're exempt from this, it's just the opposite. We are polar examples of what goes on. You know, and I'm sitting here back here thinking, you know, how do people picture sometimes what I do? And this is fresh within a couple weeks ago. You know, I'm a little picky with the things I buy at the store. I don't do online shopping. I want to go and I want to touch it and I want to see it. You know, but the steward there who was doing the groceries, you know, you get a rack of bananas and just takes and throws them in the basket. I'm thinking, what the heck? And I just looked at Barb and said, I'll just take them and put them back. You know, I said, that just frustrates me to no end. And I thought about that after we left. And think, you got that stinking upset over a $2 bunch of bananas. I don't know what kind of morning this poor lady'd had. I mean, the line was out to the back of the aisle. But I'm sure, I mean, I never said anything to her, but I'm sure she could tell by my expressions that I was not happy. And how sad is that of me to get that upset over a little bunch of bananas? You know, and I tried to picture some people who have exemplified who handles that golden rule well. And there used to be an elder when I was at Fleming Garden who was the epitome of that picture. His name was Jim Bostick. And I doubt many of you here know him. Some in the first service may know him because they used to go to Fleming Garden. But Jim Bostick was the example of gentleness. Jim Bostick was the example of patience and love to everyone. Man, when we would have an elders meeting there or we would have anything, I thought, man, I wish I could be like Jim Bostick. He was such a loving man. All the time. You know, I think of that now. That same example is given to us here, and he's probably going to be upset, but by Clyde. I'll tell you what, as I've known Clyde for 20 years now that I've been here, and he always has a smile on his face, even if he doesn't feel good or he's not having a good day. He is always encouraging to someone. I can't tell you the encouragement that he's been to me as an elder coming here. I tell you, that's an example that I want to have one day, is to think that someone looked at me as a Clyde. I don't measure up to that, and I'll just tell you that right now, I don't. I have my faults. I have a temper that's out of this world, and I hate it. Man, I just wish I had the patience of Clyde or Jim Bostick. Picture someone in your life who is living that golden rule out and try and follow that. You know, the way Bob just ended up his sermon was he says, who is benefiting from the way you're living your life. And that's what we're here now, is to celebrate communion time, where we are celebrating what Jesus did for us, who lived out that example of Matthew 7:12. He lives out the example of doing it others, as he didn't get it done back to him, but he still led the example of doing for others. And that's what we're here to celebrate now at communion time, is the cup and the loaf. So when you're ready and at your convenience, take a cup, go back to your seat, and just be dismissed at your leisure. Would you pray with me? Father, we just thank you again for this time where we can gather around the communion table. Father, gather around a time to celebrate the great victory of your Son over the cross. Father, we know even as sinners that we fall short of this communion table. But Father, we thank you for the opportunity to come, to worship, and to celebrate with you and your Son at this table. Father, just be with us now in communion time. Father, be with us through this week as we go, and help us to live out that example of treating others as you did. And see you. Amen.